The last time I was here, I gave a kind of a theoretical talk on the Black Panther Party and their lineage of revolutionary socialism and Marxist-Leninism. But this evening, it's going to be a little bit more casual as I discuss Malcolm and how the current thread has borrowed from Malcolm and has been inspired by Malcolm and continues to carry on Malcolm's legacy. Yesterday morning, May 19th, was the 91st revolutionary birthday of Brother Minister El-Haj Malik El-Shabazz, Brother Malcolm X. He was born May 19th, 1925. Brutally assassinated February 21st, 1965. And it would be just like Malcolm to request upon us to not only lift up his name, but also the name of Yuri Kochiyama, a good friend of Malcolm, and also a supporter and good friend of the Black Panther Party as well. The name Sister Lorraine Hansberry. That's right. So give some love. And certainly Ho Chi Minh. And I think Brother Malcolm would also pull my coattail to say, Lamont, you know, you forgot one important name that isn't as so-called revolutionary, but certainly deserves to be recognized, and that is Sister Grace Jones as well, May 19th. And anything that is creative, anything that is black, that is bold, that is brilliant, is revolutionary really just in its existence. Though you may not be raising a black fist, to do the things that she did was also very revolutionary. This would be the same Malcolm X who had also evolved to teach and to encompass the notion, I for one will join with anyone. I don't care what color you are as long as you want to change these miserable conditions. The same Malcolm who would tell me to celebrate all the collection of revolutionaries. Unfortunately, comrades, we're still living many of these same conditions, same miserable conditions. The same conditions that Malcolm was preaching about in 1964 and 1965. Racism and Jim Crow legal practices, police murders of black men, black women, and black children, church bombings and mass incarceration, poor housing and third-class living conditions, not only here throughout Brooklyn and Manhattan and New York, but also certainly down south and all over the U.S. Was Malcolm not talking about these very same issues 50 years ago? As we heard earlier, yes, he was. And of course, you know, Tamir Rice is no different than Emmett Till. Right. So we see the lineage is 50 years from 1965 to 2015. The same poverty now is the same poverty then. The same imperialism, the same police state. Thankfully, though, those same conditions exist today. Brother Malcolm did leave a blueprint for us to follow. Notice I said blueprint versus a winning path, right? A blueprint still has to be executed. A blueprint still has to be constructed through work and collective struggle and organizing. And I think that's the time that we're living in right now. A renewed period of work and a renewed period of struggle. A new generation of young freedom fighters have stepped up, comrades. And they're even younger than I. You know, we have a comrade right here, 21 years old. Teenagers, 20, had a sister soldier who came to Baltimore with us, who was 16 and ready to fight, a young soldier. And I think what's most kick-ass about this new generation is that Brother Malcolm is right in the swing of all of this, right back in the front lines from the depths of his grave. Believe it or not, comrades, other than maybe Beyonce, right? Does anyone know who Beyonce is? Yeah. I don't think any heard of her, right? I don't think anyone is being studied and paid more homage to right now than Malcolm X. It's a very interesting note, but it's real. Beyonce even put Brother Malcolm front and center on her most recent album. Have any of you all heard the new album?
Lemonade.
Okay, all right, okay. So, you know, for those of you, yes, Lemonade. And Lemonade as in how black folk, black women, black children, black men have always taken America's lemons and taken those lemons and made lemonade out of the very existence of our lives, made it into something sweet that people would like and enjoy, right? And the album features Malcolm X live as if he were almost talking in your left ear, and he says, "The most disrespected person in America is the black woman. The most unprotected person in America is the black woman. The most neglected person in America is the black woman." And I tell you, comrades, to hear that for the first time on the album as I'm watching the video, the digital album, it really just kind of sent shivers to my body. And it's something about his voice, the pitch, all that. It's just the power, the resistance, it's all there. And she placed that on her album. And I couldn't help but to think of Sandra Bland, you know, murdered by police in a Texas jail cell, Rakia Boyd, and 7-year-old Ayanna Stanley Jones, murdered by the Detroit Police Department while she was sleeping. And for all the criticism she receives, you know, to put Malcolm on your album as kind of a pop star, as an international icon, just to do that is revolutionary. It is. And I want to break this down because, you know, I have a 6 and an 8-year-old daughter, so to speak, that I'm taking care of, two daughters. And I think you have to see the potential of this to really understand its power when you have not only black girls, but girls of color all over the world as young as 6 years old, now Googling Malcolm X on their phones and their iPads, reading about him, writing about him, learning about him, not in the public school system, but on their own independent, free-thinking, revolutionary terms. Right here in Manhattan, I'm pretty sure right now, somewhere, there's a crew, a posse of 12 and 13-year-old black girls who are braiding each other's hair right now, talking about the introduction on Beyonce's Lemonade, Malcolm's sampled voice. That's happening right now in 2016, and I think we really have to kind of be creative about how we really imagine that and the ramifications of that politically and intellectually. And that's the kind of enthusiasm that we have not seen for Malcolm X in probably 40 years, comrades. A good friend of mine, Dr. Ashley Farmer, who's currently working on her postdoc at Duke right now, she just published a very, very good article on Malcolm X. It's entitled "The Many Women Mentors of Malcolm X." And it really is a must read. Sister Ashley released this piece via the African American Intellectual History Society May 3rd. And ever since, it's been going viral via Twitter, Facebook, and it's something because you knew Malcolm was in Ferguson in 2014 because the foot soldiers were talking about him, and you knew Malcolm was in Baltimore in 2015, but to have Malcolm now being talked about in the academy at the Ivy level, to me, that means that there's some good conversations going on from the ground all the way on high. As the state is clamped down and honorable and decent employment has dried up, as conditions have worsened and white supremacy has once again mounted an ugly surge via the Trump campaign and also the resurgence of the Ku Klux Klan down south, you've seen youth seek the guidance in their old friend, Malcolm X. The youth in Ferguson, the youth in Baltimore, the youth in Palestine. Black girls and black boys discovering Malcolm X for the first time. I think the reasons he has reemerged are multifaceted. Not only was Malcolm ahead of his time regarding the role of women and women's liberation, Malcolm was thinking, traveling, and organizing internationally in the early 1960s. Long before social media, Twitter, the internet, Instagram. Now, of course, those things helped us mobilize and help and continue to help us mobilize and organize today. But Malcolm did not have that. But he did organize a very similar network for himself globally. Cuba, Ghana, Egypt, Algeria. Interestingly, when I was in Lebanon last year for the International Forum for Justice in Palestine, it was the youth in Algeria, the youth in Tunisia, who really, really took a liking in conversation about Malcolm X. And I learned firsthand that Malcolm is still very much so a bridge of internationalism, revolutionary internationalism worldwide. When Malcolm stated in 1964 that it is incorrect to classify the revolt of the Negro as simply a racial conflict against of black against white, or as purely an American problem. Rather, we are today seeing a global rebellion of the oppressed versus the oppressor, the exploited against the exploiter. I think the youth really took to that then, and it's so, so obvious that the youth are taking even more to it now. This renewed brand of international solidarity was no question inspired by Malcolm X as early as 1959. There's also another recent phenomenon that was inspired by Malcolm X. One of the current and very beautiful aspects of the Black Lives Matter movement is this emphasis on things that are black. And for me, it's a big deal because I wasn't born during the 60s. I was born in 79, and I didn't catch any of the Afro movement and any of the Black Arts movement, right? And today, not only do Black Lives Matter, but the masses of black youth are now very unapologetically black, right? It's a hashtag. You're seeing it as a phrase on shirts and hats. Black youth are wearing their hair natural again. My sister is wearing her hair natural again. The young sisters today have said the hell with straightening their hair. They're going to rock their low cuts, like Monica, their locks and braids and cornrows, their natural coils and twists. And it's not only happening in North Carolina, but it's happening nationwide. And this mental shift is not only occurring aesthetically speaking, right? But it's also a reflection of a political and a cultural shift. Some people think this kind of thing isn't important, but personally, I think it is. If you don't have any pride in who you are, how in the hell can you be a good freedom fighter? If you do not love yourself and the very essence and beauty of who you are and who your people are and where you've come from, the struggles that you've been able to mount against and resist, you've already lost basically before you can even get started. You have to love yourself and love your people, and then you have a cause to fight for. A worthy cause, a righteous cause, the kind of cause that will make you sacrifice, as Long was saying, for the next generation, out of love, out of pride, solidarity. We learned that from Brother Malcolm, and it's priceless. Last year, during the Movement for Black Lives convening in Cleveland, we actually lived that feeling in a genuine manifestation. Yes, my brother. Personally, I had never experienced anything like that before, and I'm not kidding. Everybody there was black and proud. I thought me and Imani were going to be the only two. Right? But no, we were not. Everyone was. And it wasn't the kind of proud that is arrogant or boastful. It was the kind of proud that makes you fight back. It was the kind of proud that makes you shut shit the fuck down. Right. It was the kind of pride that makes you stand up instead of laying down and begging. The kind of pride that makes you resist and hold your head high. Despite the tanks, despite the National Guard, despite the tear gas. It was Malcolm who gave us that. And the young people have taken that today, comrades, and really run with it. Let's help this generation go as far as they can with what they have taken from Brother Malcolm. Let's get behind them. Let's keep Malcolm alive. In the words of El-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. And our deeds, the proper time, in all our deeds, the proper value and respect for time determines success or failure. All power to the people. Disrespectful to Brother Malcolm if I did not mention the only male heir to Malcolm, his grandson, Malik Shabazz, who was murdered, who was assassinated. We know that. We in Mexico, we don't hear about Malik Shabazz very often. But as I was going on the delegation with Sarah and Ramsey and Cynthia to Libya, to Syria and Lebanon, I thought about how just a few weeks after Malik Shabazz came back from a delegation with Cynthia McKinney in Libya, here he was in Mexico being assassinated. His grandson went through the issues, getting himself together politically, intellectually, spiritually. And just as this young brother was ascending right to his rightful place as a freedom fighter, young, he was taken out. So I think you said it so best, you know, every time there's some sort of gain by the oppressed, here's the oppressor, you know, with every single chain that they can possibly pull and trick they can pull, you know, taking out folk who are making these sacrifices. So Sister Maya in Boston, myself and several other folk, you know, are trying to really raise this banner around Malik Shabazz, because hardly no one talks about it, and you did not hear about it at all in the media. So, you know, comrades, do some research. I'm going to continue to do my research, and hopefully we can get this story about, you know, Malcolm's only grandson, who certainly was a target the day he was born. So I just wanted to raise that, you know, in solidarity and in all truth.